Okay, so this study here is, this is going to get into the Word of God specifically, who he is, how he operates, and how this is according to his character, and his character basically is described in the names he's had. I've gotten into that a little bit before. It'll be gone into a little bit here as far as his names, but basically, his character, his mode of operation, his name, this all is one. God's word is who he is. And so, in an attempt to convey this, according to what the scriptures say, that's what this study is going to be about. So, it got into it a little bit in the description, and so here I'm going to start with Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 through 4. God, after he spoke long ago to the fathers and the prophets in many portions and many ways, in these last days has spoken to us in his Son, who he appointed heir of all things, through whom he also made the world. And he is the radiance of his glory and the exact representation of his nature. So right there, he is the exact representation of his nature. And it's what he says of himself. He describes himself by the names he's given throughout scripture. And like Christ the door, nobody comes unto the Father but through him. He is the way and the truth and the life. So he upholds all things by the word of his power. When he has made purification of sins, he sat down at the right hand of the majesty on high, having become as much better than the angels as he has inherited a more excellent name than they. And then John chapter 1 verses 1 through 5, as I've often quoted in the past, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things came into being through him, and apart from him, nothing came into being that's come into being. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it. All things that have been made, all things that the physical senses perceive, all things in the spirit, which is just as real as the five senses, if not more real. The things of the spirit govern the physical world. As everybody is going to see, whether they mock it, whether they disagree, whether they agree, whether they just simply acknowledge it and continue on their own way, it doesn't matter. All are going to stand before God at the end of time. When their time is done, invariably, they stand before God and God renders his judgment. And nobody's getting into the kingdom of God if they don't know Jesus. He's the only way. And this time can be seen as a time of testing, but it's a fallen world dictated by the devil at this point in time. At least so he thinks. God is still on his throne above it all. Heaven did not fall to the devil. It was the earth that fell to the devil. Man was given authority over the earth. Man was deceived. That is Adam, translated in Hebrew to man. And so he handed it over to the devil, and the devil now has the authority that God originally created for man. But the church is not subject to that. The church answers only to God. And because Christ gave them all authority over all the power of the enemy, over the devil, over those who follow the devil, even the fallen angels that follow after the devil, Jesus, who is the Word of God, who is God, gave those who call on him and seek after him and live for him all authority. So that means all authority. And the Gospels, through the very words of Jesus, elaborate on this, what this means, how it's applied. And the apostles also did their best in their writings to teach the church and elaborate on this. So John chapter 10, verse 30. I and the Father are one. Jesus says right there, He and his Father are one and the same. And as John chapter 1 verses 1 through 5 describe, he is also the Word of God, and God is Spirit. He sends his Spirit to dwell in his people, and yet he's still on the throne. Where God is, there is no time, as we know it here. Because creation became finite, and thus had an end at its fall into sin, when the devil gained control over it, by God's judgment, this is a limited thing. He isn't going to tolerate it for long. And the Apostle Peter, through revelation of God, and everything the Bible teaches is true, okay? It's proven in the world. I've seen this myself, and it's not hard to understand. A day is as 1,000 years. 1,000 years is as a day to God. This is a fleeting vapor, our time here, and this is what James teaches, and it is true. As much as time seems to drag on to a child who just came into the world, to an older adult, everything blurs together. Time passes quickly, and for the one who is timeless, it's the blink of an eye. So, to him, he's judging everything immediately, if that elaborates on it. So, he's not slow. And so, because of this, we perceive this thing called time in a linear existence here in creation. But at the end of the span of time allotted for a fallen creation, then the heavens and the earth get remade. And that's described in the book of Revelation. It's the last book of the Bible, if it's hard to find. So, continuing on here. Psalms 107, verses 19 to 20. Then they cried out to the Lord in their trouble. He saved them out of their distresses. He sent his word and healed them and delivered them from their destructions. And this goes hand in hand with Mark chapter 16, verses 15 to 20, where those who live and preach and teach the Gospels, the Word of God, signs follow that as they go around doing as the Lord did, demonstrating what the Lord demonstrated for that right way, who he is. And so, Romans chapter 10, verses 8 to 13, elaborating more on exactly who the Word of God is. But what does it say? The Word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart. That is the Word of faith which we are preaching, that if you confess with your mouth Jesus as Lord and believe in your hearts that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart a person believes, resulting in righteousness, and with the mouth he confesses, resulting in salvation. For the scripture says, whoever believes in him will not be disappointed, for there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. For the same Lord is Lord of all, abounding in riches for all who call on him. Whoever will call on the name of the Lord will be saved. And that's the message of salvation. Dedicating your life to him and living for him and developing a relationship with him. Jesus, the Christ of God, the door of the sheepfold. And what Jesus says is that there are those who knock on the door when their time here is done, saying, Lord, Lord, let us in. Didn't we serve you? Didn't we preach and teach your word and demonstrate signs following, working for you? And he says, I never knew you. Depart from me, you worker of iniquity. It's relationship with God, hearing him, spending time in him, not just doing a scholarly read of his word and attempting to mimic it. You need relationship with God. You need to pray in the Spirit. You need to talk with him. Bring your concerns to him and hear him. Fellowship with him. He is a person. And so, the word is near you in your mouth and in your heart. And this is speaking to unsaved people. So, in the Old Testament, Jeremiah even says, God knows us before we were formed. He knew us in our mother's womb. So, we proceeded from God. We are spirit being first. We were already in the Spirit before we were manifest in the flesh. However, What determines where we go is our confession and what we do following that. That's why water baptism, the outward statement to the world of our change in ways, is so critically important. And even Jesus did that to fulfill all righteousness. And even Acts chapter 2, verse 38, and Acts chapter 10. Even though the house of Cornelius already got baptized in the Spirit of God, they still had to fulfill all righteousness and get baptized. So, that way they had good solid footing for when they stood before the Lord. And even though God met them before they were baptized, they still needed that outward declaration for all to see. So, if this puts things in perspective or relates some understanding in the matter as to why the scriptures are worded the way they are worded, because that is how it is. So, Isaiah chapter 55, verses 8 to 11. But here, because you are spirit and you came from God, the word is near you, in your mouth and in your heart, and you are made in the image of God. You are made to be his children. And so, you're already connected with him. But if you're not going to live for him, like any disobedient child, when they come to a certain point in time, they get kicked out of dad's house. So, the devil and his angels, those who follow after him, have been kicked out of his house. So, where do you go? Well, you go with them to the place prepared for those disobedient beings. So, it's a place where you don't want to wind up for eternity. Isaiah 55, verses 8 to 11. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, nor are my ways, nor are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. For as the heavens are higher than the earths, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For as the rain and the snow come down from heaven, and do not return there without watering the earth and making it bear and sprout, furnishing seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so will my word be which goes forth from my mouth, and it will not return to me empty, without accomplishing what I desire, and without succeeding in the matter to which I have sent it. And here he points out, his word is going to accomplish its purpose to which it is sent. God is truth, so creation has to conform to what he speaks. And what this gets into, you may think that the words coming out of your mouth, because they're Bible scripture and you believe that speak to the mountain and it will move, you have to first hear it in your spirit. God will give you the words to speak, and then you'll see the signs following, which is why it's so critically important to be baptized in both water and the Spirit of God and live for him and have relationship with him. Because when you know his voice and he tells you to do something, he's going to come behind it and you're going to see awesome things happen. Exodus chapter 34, verses 12 to 14. Watch yourself that you make no covenant with the inhabitants of the land into which you are going, or it will become a snare in your midst. Rather, you are to tear down their altars and smash their sacred pillars and cut down their asherim. You shall not worship any other god, for the Lord, whose name is Jealous, is a jealous God. Do not be bound together with unbelievers. For what partnership has righteousness with lawlessness? Or what fellowship has light with darkness? Or what harmony has Christ with Belial? Or what has a believer in common with an unbeliever? Or what agreement has the temple of God with idols? For we are the temple of the living God, just as God said, I will dwell in them and walk among them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Therefore come out from their midst and be separate, says the Lord. Do not touch what is unclean, and I will welcome you, and I will be a father to you, and you shall be my sons and daughters to me, says the Lord Almighty. So, this is speaking to righteous living all the time. Not just a marriage, as some would like to argue. Well, that's pertaining to marriage with unbelievers. No, that's all the time. Some people try to, like, twist scripture around their own agenda so that their favorite sin can be like swept under the carpet or something. I have no idea why people try to say it means this or that when it clearly is, well, it's a clear statement. This is righteous living. You cannot be yoked together with unbelievers, as in marriage, but it also means your connections, like your friends, your family. I know there's different situations, like children living under their parents' roof. You have to do the best you can there, but you serve God first and man second. You have to do what's right with him, and you can't go against what him. If you deny Christ before men, you'll be denied by Christ before God, and you won't make it into his kingdom. That's what Jesus says. So you have to hold fast to the word of God and never let go, even if all other conditions are against you on that. That way, you're saved and you give glory to God in your living. For our God is a consuming fire. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 29. So this lends a whole new seriousness to James chapter 4, verses 1 to 10. Draw near to God and he will draw near to you. And as you draw near to him, all that stuff that James spoke of in the preceding verses are going to be burned off. Wrong motives, covetous ways, iniquity of every kind, wickedness of every kind, the works of the flesh. They are not going to withstand the door of the sheepfold, who is a consuming fire. Only those precious things to God are what will remain after you pass through his fire, which, if you're his, you won't be consumed. So, gotta make sure this pop-up is off the screen here. All right. So, 1 Corinthians chapter 3 is where we're going to go next, because that God is the door of the sheepfold, he is jealous for his own, and that he is a consuming fire that is going to burn away the dross, the impurities from that precious thing, which is his child, as a way of putting it, as best as I can here. So, 1 Corinthians chapter 3. Because of God's grace to me, I have laid the foundation. This is starting at verse 10. I have laid the foundation like a master builder. Now others are building on it, but whoever is building on this foundation must be very careful, for no one can lay a foundation any other than the one we already have, Jesus Christ. Anyone who builds on that foundation may use a variety of materials: gold, silver, jewels, or wood, hay, and straw. But on the judgment day, fire will reveal what kinds of work each builder has done. The fire will show if a person's work has any value. Because you're crossing from what is finite, what is temporary, what is corrupt, into what is eternal and pure and righteous. If the work survives, that builder will receive a reward, and those precious things are eternal things. But if the work is burned up, the builder will suffer great loss. The builder will be saved, but like someone barely escaping through a wall of flames. Don't you realize that all of you together are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God lives in you? God will destroy anyone who destroys this temple, for God's temple is holy, and that is who you are. Stop deceiving yourselves. If you think you are wise by this world's standards, you will need to become a fool to be truly wise. Putting aside all that you think you know and understand as to how the world works and how people are, you're going to have to throw all that aside, because God has a different way. His great commission is to seek and save that which is lost, to reach out to them and draw them in, to teach people about him and his better way. And you may be surprised. The word of God might actually be accepted by a desperate people who need what actually works for their soul, for their spirit, and for life. Stop deceiving yourselves. You need to become a fool to be truly wise, putting aside the wisdom of the world for the wisdom of God. The wisdom of this world is foolishness to God, as the scriptures say, traps the wise in the snare of their own cleverness. And again, the Lord knows the thoughts of the wise, He knows they are worthless. So don't boast about following a particular human leader, for everything belongs to you. Whether Paul or Apollos or Peter or the world or life, death or the present and the future, everything belongs to you. You belong to Christ and Christ belongs to God. So, when the name of Jesus is translated in Hebrew, Yeshua, which translates to Joshua, the meaning of it is salvation, and the meaning of the word Christ is anointing. The word of God is salvation and the anointing of God and the power to get the job done. The spirit of salvation, the spirit of anointing, that spirit of power, which is made to dwell in the children of God. This is the word of God who came as a Jewish man in the flesh and ascended to the right hand of God in heaven. John chapter 14, verse 6, I am the way and the truth and the life, and no one comes unto the Father but through me. And that word of God, that anointing of God, that salvation of God is a consuming fire, the door of the sheepfold through which we all must pass. Which is why we need to make sure that our motives are right and what we are doing has eternal value according to the scriptures of the Bible, the word of God. Because our God is a consuming fire, anything that is not built of precious works that are for his glory and for his kingdom, these are burned up. Cursed is anyone who hangs upon a tree, is what the Bible teaches. Cast your yoke, your burden to me, says the Lord. I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. I will give you rest because my yoke is easy, my burden is light, says the Lord. To be yoked to the word of God and to bear that, which may bring the reproach of the world, and as Jesus says, it will. All that call on him and live for him will know persecution. When they step into the kind of ministry that brings signs followings, that will happen. It'll make empty religious leaders jealous, and they'll bring a persecution, much like the Pharisees of Jesus' day. And the world of the unsaved, who don't know anything about the scriptures, may strike them as being a ridiculous thing, but as often is the case, as demonstrated in the Gospels, some of these Gentiles saw the real fruit of it and came to the Lord, looking to be partakers of the covenant. When you cast something that is combustible into a fire, it is consumed and burned to ashes. So the things that we cast to the Lord that have been weighing us down and holding us back, the Lord burns them with his fire, and they are no more because he is a consuming fire. So those old dead things are completely erased. So don't go looking for them again. Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded. Stop looking for old dead things. Stop trying to find those old works that did nothing for you. Pursue God. He will raise you up. He will build you up as a people to his glory. Hallelujah. So, he's true to his word, but you need to be in covenant with him. You need to live for Jesus. You need to have Jesus as your Lord and Savior of your life. You need to live for him, follow him, do as his word instructs. So, all are under sin on this side of creation. If you're a physical, living, breathing human, you need Jesus. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. The Bible reads, all have sinned and have come short of the glory of God. So, you are a whosoever. So I'll say a quick prayer for you. Lord, bless these people with long and healthy lives and do a quick work in their hearts that if they haven't received you, Lord, I pray they'll do so now. So repeat after me. Dear Lord Jesus, come into my heart, forgive me of my sin, wash me and cleanse me and set me free. Jesus, thank you that you died for me. I believe that you are risen from the dead and that you're coming back again for me. Fill me with the Holy Spirit, give me a passion for the lost and a hunger for the things of God and a holy boldness to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. I'm saved, I'm born again, I'm forgiven, and I'm on my way to heaven because I have Jesus in my heart. Amen. So I tell you today, as a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ, all your sins are forgiven. Always remember to run to God and not from Him, because He loves you. He has an awesome plan for your life. So God bless you.